Okay students, so welcome back. Good evening to all. So we are back for this most probable question series for prelims 2024. Okay, so as you know, if you have seen our earlier videos, we have completed the recurring topics section from the polity. Now in today's class, we will try to complete the current affair related topics from polity. Okay, so basically there will be no direct questions from current affairs in polity in prelims. Generally you may get asked in mains exam, but in polity prelims examination, based on the current affair topics, they will ask you from the respective static topic. Okay, so we will try to finish off as much as possible today. I think we will be able to complete this complete current affairs in one go. Okay, so let us start. So as you know, this is a most probable series, prediction series. So in today's class, we will try to complete more and more topics of current affairs rather than doing questions. Okay, so there will be no questions, just the topics, and you will be able to solve the questions based on them easily. Okay, so let us start with the first thing. So these are the topics that I have enlisted here. There might be few more also, we'll see. Okay, so Citizenship Amendment Act, Schedule 5-6, Legislative Control, 10th Schedule, Representation of People's Act, as we are approaching Lok Sabha election, so we need to see, look at this also. Then Bharatiya Nyaya Sanhita, the new three laws of the law which have actually replaced our previous CRPC, CPC, IPC, etc. And a few doctrines that Supreme Court have been using recently. Okay, we will see few doctrines of Supreme Court. And the most famous ED and PMLA Act and electoral bonds. Okay, let us start. So first thing is Citizenship Amendment Act. So citizenship we have seen in our last class, in our recurring topic class. So let us look at the Amendment Act, which has happened already in 2019. But why it is important? Because recently central government has put forward the rules of this act. Okay, so this act relates to what? Relates to one of the acquisition, citizenship acquisition thing. Okay, so what are the ways by which we can acquire citizenship of India? Either by birth, by descent, by registration, by incorporation of territory, or by naturalization. So this act revolves around the concept of naturalization. Okay, so just to freshen up your memory, by birth means if you are born in India and you have one of the parent is a citizen of India and another is not an illegal immigrant, then you are citizen by birth. By descent, for example, you are born outside India, one of your parents is a citizen of India, and you have to register at the consulate there within 1 year of your birth, then you are citizen of India by descent. Registration, for example, for the OCI card holders, the overseas citizen of India, or PIOs, person of Indian origins, they can get citizenship by registration. They have to stay in India for 5 years before applying for the citizenship. By incorporation of territory, simply by incorporating territory, all the citizens will be citizen of India. Next is naturalization. So how you will get citizenship by naturalization? Naturalization is a process for any person. Okay, need not to be a PIO, OCI card holder, nothing like that. You can become citizen of India by naturalization process if you stay in India for at least 11 years before application of such citizenship. Okay, so you need to stay 11 years before applying for citizenship in India. This is naturalization clause for any person. Now the issue in this amendment act, or the changes that this amendment act made, was in this naturalization. What did the Citizenship Amendment Act did? It exempted exemption from what? From naturalization clause. From this clause, it exempted six religions: Hindus, Sikhs, Parsis, Christian, Jain, Buddhist, who will be arriving in India or immigrant in India, illegal immigrants in India, from Afghanistan, Pakistan and Bangladesh. These three countries, six religions and three countries. These six religious people, religion, and those people of this religious identity coming from these three countries are being exempted from naturalization clause. Okay, so this clause has been amended for these people, and now it has been reduced to only 5 years. These people need to stay in India for only 5 years before applying for the citizenship. So what was the date? So the cutoff date was 2014. December 2014 was the cutoff date. Means these people of six religion from these three countries, if they are they have arrived in India before this date, they are not eligible for this citizenship. Okay, they have to come to India after this date. So that's the limit of the date, and they need to stay in India for only 5 years before application of the act. Okay, so now 5 years have been completed. So for example, a person coming to India from, let's say, Afghanistan, who was a Parsi, let's say 2020, 5 years are done. Now we can apply for the citizenship act. So that is the clause. But there are few conditions. Okay, for example, you cannot settle the immigrants. Immigrants from these countries cannot settle in any part of the country. Okay, there are some limitations here. What are the limitations? They cannot settle. This act is not applicable to where? Schedule 6 areas. What are Schedule 6 areas? These are the tribal areas mentioned in the constitution. For example, few areas of Assam, few areas of Meghalaya, few areas of Tripura and Mizoram. Okay. So the Schedule 6 areas of these states, these people cannot reside in. Okay. So how will this area look like? For example, if I draw a map of India, it looks something like this in Northeast. So this is Assam. This is Assam. This is Meghalaya. Okay. This upper part is Assam. This is Meghalaya. This is Tripura and this is Mizoram. So basically, all of these countries are adjacent to Bangladesh. Okay. And those are tribal areas. They have their own set of rules. We will see Schedule 6 also in the next slide. So basically, these are exempted. These people cannot enter Schedule 6 areas of these states. It is not allowed. Okay. Then they are not applicable even on ILP states. Now what are ILP states? ILP states not applicable to ILP state. They cannot reside in ILP states also. ILP means inner line permit. Means there are few states in India, to visit them even we, the citizen of India, need to get permission. What is the permission? Inner line permit to visit that state. For example, Arunachal Pradesh, we need ILP, inner line permit. It's like a visa, okay, within the country, visa within the country. Arunachal Pradesh, then Nagaland, Manipur and Mizoram. These are the states. Which are the states? For example, this is Arunachal Pradesh, this will be Nagaland, this will be Manipur and this is Mizoram. So these four states. So basically complete Northeast have been, not say completely excluded, but most of the part was excluded from this act. Okay, so this is ILP states. There are few more ILP states also. For example, Lakshadweep also ILP. You need to get inter-line permit to visit Lakshadweep and also some part of Sikkim. So this is the inter-line permit. So where it is not applicable, it is not the these guys cannot settle in Schedule 6 areas in Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura, Mizoram, and not cannot settle in ILP states, Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur, Nagaland, Mizoram. Okay, so this is the basic idea of the act. One more thing was mentioned in this act, which was not related to this citizenship. It was mentioned that they mentioned extra cancellation ground for OCI card holders. For example, overseas citizen of India, after getting citizenship of India, that their citizenship can get cancelled by various ways. One more way was added in this act, that was violation of a law as notified by the center. This is not important. This is just to mention you that only these things are not mentioned in this act. There was one more thing of related to overseas citizen of India also. Then what is the fuss about everything in this act? So majorly the act was challenged on Article 14, that is equality before law. Equality before law. Now, as you know, Article 14 is applicable not only to citizens of India but also to other persons. Okay. So basically, if you apply Article 14, equality before law, how can you segregate people on the basis of religion? That was the main question here. Okay. But there are some restrictions over all the fundamental rights. No fundamental right is absolute. And then government also, the government defense was that these countries, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Bangladesh, they have Islam as their state religion. Okay. None other countries has Islam as a state religion. These countries have Islam as a state religion. Hence, other than Islam, these are the minorities there. Okay. So that's why we have given a special consideration to them. So equality before law was one of the issue. Then next issue was Assam Accord. Now what was Assam Accord? Now as you know, Bangladesh was separated from West Pakistan in 1971. Now by that time various illegal immigrants from Bangladesh entered into various northeast states, especially Assam, because of the similarity of languages or the area, topography, etc. So what was happening, there was a protest in Assam in those times, 1970s, to remove this, to deport these illegal immigrants back to Bangladesh. So in this conflict, MOU, Memorandum of Understanding, was signed between Government of India and the Assam National Movement. Okay, so what was this accord? All the people, all the immigrants, all the illegal immigrants who have entered India after 24th March 1971 should be deported back to Bangladesh, irrespective of their religion. Now a person who has entered India after this date, whether he be Muslim, Hindu, Sikh, Christian, whatever his religion may be, he needs to be deported according to this Assam Accord, which was signed between the government and the Assam National Movement. Now, this act allows this religion from Bangladesh to enter India. Okay, that means to enter Assam also. Now, I have mentioned 6th schedule here. Assam contains 6th schedule, but those are limited areas. Complete Assam cannot be considered as 6th schedule areas. So, people can enter into Assam. So that is why there is huge protest in Assam regarding this act. So that protest in Assam is not based on religion. They want everyone who has entered in India after this date to be deported back to Bangladesh, irrespective of their religion. But this act nullifies this Assam Accord in a particular sense. Okay. So this was the issue with Assam Accord. Then the other questions which arose in this act was, where are the other minorities? For example, you know, Ahmadiyyas. Now they are also minorities in Ahmadiyyas are type of Muslims only, but they are minorities in Pakistan. They are being persecuted there. Then Uyghur Muslims in China are being persecuted. Then Tamilians in Sri Lanka are being persecuted. So why are we not included? Other countries, Sri Lanka, China, you are not included. Other minority religions, for example, Jews are not included here. So what about them? So this was the question. So, but again, the government in its defense said, this is the just the starting of that. We can include more and more countries, more and more persecuted persons or group in future amendments. Okay, so that was the case here. So this is regarding Constitutional Amendment Act. Hope you get the idea. Okay, so this might be useful in your mains also. Now we are talking about Schedule 6. Schedule 6 was also in news. Why? Because after the state of Jammu Kashmir been disintegrated into Union Territories of Jammu and Union Territories of Ladakh. Now, as you know, Jammu will have its assembly, but Ladakh is without assembly. So what they are asking, they are protesting that Ladakh should be included in Schedule 6 areas. What are the Schedule 6 areas? We have already seen. These are the tribal areas of Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura and Mizoram. Ladakh wants such a protection under Schedule 6 also. Okay, so we will see Schedule 6. Now, as you know, Schedule 6 and Schedule 5, they are to be read in one go. So we will talk about Schedule 5 first and then we'll go to Schedule 6. Okay. You should know all the schedules, okay? For example, Schedule 1 regarding Union and Territories. Schedule 2 is regarding salaries of officers and president, etc. Everything is mentioned in there. Schedule 3 is regarding oaths. Schedule 4 is breakup and allocation of seats in Rajya Sabha. Schedule 5 is this schedule areas, we will see. Schedule 6 tribal areas, we will see that also. Schedule 7 is regarding distribution of items. For example, state list, union list, concurrent list. Schedule 8, these are languages which are being included in Schedule 8, which are constitution has recognized them as scheduled languages. Then Schedule 9 is the Schedule 9 which was added in First Amendment Act to save the acts from getting checked under judicial review. Okay, that was the, this has become redundant now. Schedule 10th is the 10th schedule which we will see today. Schedule 11th is the items or subjects which are to be delegated from the state to the panchayats, and schedule 12, these are the items or subjects which are to be delegated by the state to the municipalities. So these are the schedules. Now what is schedule 5? So schedule 5 means if a state has scheduled tribes, there are scheduled tribes in a particular state, then president has a power to mention a particular area of that state to be called as the scheduled area. Okay, this is different than tribal areas, they are called as scheduled area. Okay, most of the powers here belong to the president. For example, currently there are 10 states in India which have scheduled areas in them. Not all complete area is not scheduled area, part of the states are scheduled areas. For example, states like Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Odisha, Telangana, then if you go up Madhya Pradesh, Himachal Pradesh, there are 10 states currently which have scheduled area in them. Who decide the scheduled areas? Declaration of the scheduled area is done by the president. For example, name of the scheduled area of the scheduled area, to increase the area of the scheduled area, to decrease the area of the scheduled area, okay, to make away with the scheduled area also, that can be also decided by the president in consultation with the governor of the state. Then there is a legislative body also. For example, we call it as a TAC or Tribal Advisory Council. There shall be a Tribal Advisory Council in such scheduled areas, and that is to be set up under presidential order. Okay, president's order will set up a Tribal Advisory Council in those scheduled areas of these 10 states. Okay, so this Tribal Advisory Council consists of 20 members, 20 MLAs, 20 members, out of which 3/4 should be tribal MLAs. Okay, means 3/4 should be from scheduled tribes. Okay, 3/4 should be tribal MLAs. This tribal area council can be set up in those states which are not included in scheduled areas, but they have scheduled tribes in them. Okay, means there may be few states that have scheduled tribes in them, but president have not yet declared scheduled areas within the state. In those states also, tribal area council can be set up by presidential order. So this is, tribal area council has some their own legislative powers. They can set up rules, regulations regarding for example land rights, transferability of land, money lending, etc., etc. Okay, but those regulations are done by governor in consultation with this council, and those regulations will require president's assent. Okay, president's approval will be required. So there are various subjects such as land transfer, land allocation, then money lending, etc. Rules can be made on this by the governor in consultation with TAC, but all those rules will require president's assent, approval. Okay, so this is one thing regarding schedule 5. We are talking about schedule 5. We will see schedule 6 in next slide. Now if a act of a state, okay, act of a state or a union is to be applied in such scheduled areas, then the governor will decide if it is applicable or not. Okay, governor is empowered to direct the act of state or union is not applicable in such areas unless it has been modified by the governor. Okay, so governor has a right to modify such acts made by state union, and then only they can be applicable in those areas. So basically, act of state union cannot be directly applicable in such areas. Then governor make regulation consultation with TAC, requires president approval. We have already seen it. So this is regarding schedule 5 areas. So basically, most of the powers available in schedule 5 is through the president. Fine. Then we'll come to schedule 6. So schedule 6 areas, now already seen schedule 6 areas is currently having 4 states, that is mentioned in constitution: Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura and Mizoram. Okay, so as the schedule areas are given by presidential order by president, the declaration of tribal areas is done by the governor. So basically, most of the power here is with respect to the governor. In schedule 5 areas, most of the power was in hands of president. Here governor is more important. So declaration of such tribal areas will be with the governor. Okay, so in this case, schedule 6, in schedule 5 we have seen TAC, tribal area council. In this case we have autonomous district council or autonomous regional council. Okay, so ADC and ARC. Now these are also set up by directly by the governor. Okay, in that case TAC was set up by president. In this case ADC, autonomous district council, and ARC, autonomous regional council, is set up by the governor. So with, if it is limited to particular district, then it is called autonomous district council. If combinedly it is made, it is called as autonomous regional council. Okay, so these councils, as the TAC, have certain rights, certain powers, even power to legislate on the few subjects. Okay, so these, now composition of TAC, we have seen 20 members, out of which two-thirds are to be tribal MLAs. In this case, the constitution, the composition of this ADC or ARCs, the election of this ADC or ARCs, everything, every rule is made by the governor in consultation with the councils. Okay, everything, the rules are made by the governor. So what is the current rule is that the ADC and ARC have, there are 30 members. Okay, 30 members, out of which 26 are elected for 5 years and 4 are nominated by the governor. Okay, 4 are nominated by the governor. So they remain in the house, they remain in the office until the pleasure of the governor, but these will get re-elected after 5 years. So this is the composition, and they are elected among themselves, or whatever the governor says, the governor will decide the rule. Okay, 30 member council. Generally all the autonomous district council, for example, there are various district council in each of the four states that I've mentioned here. Example is Bodoland autonomous district council, regional council, etc. So majorly most of the councils have 30 members in it. There are some exceptions which have members more than 30, but that is not the case. The main thing is that it is limited to 30 members. Then ADCs, ARCs, or the, now we have seen the acronym. So autonomous district council, autonomous regional council can make laws on various subjects similar, the basically the political religious subjects or social subjects or the land related subjects, money lending subjects, etc. So those laws can be made, laws with respect to those subjects can be made by the ARC and the ADC. Okay, and but it requires governor's action. That there it required president's action, here it requires governor's action. Okay, now if I may do here two types of subjects. Okay, for example, those subjects on which ADC or ARC, autonomous district council or autonomous regional council, can make laws, and other subjects which can the state or the union, only these two can make laws. Okay, so for time being, just divide subjects in two parts: those subjects which can be legislated by autonomous district and regional council, and other. If state start making laws on these subjects, okay, on those subjects which have been given to autonomous councils to govern, on those subjects if state make any law, then those law cannot be directly applicable on such areas unless that are to be extended by the council. Means any such law made by the state on these subjects, if a state make law on such subjects, then they need to be extended or approved by this council. They need to be approved by this council, then only those laws will be applicable. For other items, means for other laws, for other subjects, if for other subjects, governor is empowered to direct the states that such laws are not applicable in that areas, only applicable if governor has made some correction in it. Okay, so governor is empowered to say that such laws, other subjects, not applicable in such areas. Governor is empowered to direct the act of union. Now I am talking about state here. Now here is union. Act of union not applicable in case of Assam, and president has power to direct the act of union not applicable in place of Meghalaya, Tripura and Mizoram. So these are some nitty-gritties. You need not to go in that detail, but still we don't know what can be asked in the exam, and there is no chance of elimination technique now, so you should know everything. So basically what it is saying, that if on other subjects state government make any law, then those laws also not applicable unless governor have made certain required changes in it. Okay, and from other subjects, if union has made any law, then In case of Assam, it is governor who will make changes and then the law applicable to Assam. But in case of other three states, it will be president who will be empowered to direct that such law is not applicable unless made changes by the president. Okay. So these are the details regarding Schedule 6. Now we'll come to legislative controls. Control means legislation. We know we have a parliamentary type of system. Okay. So there is no perfect or a watertight compartmentalization of executive and legislature. Okay. So there is no such compartmentalization. So executive is also part of a legislature. So how can legislature get control over the executives? So there are few elements which can be helpful to have control over the executive. So what are those? For example, first is question hour. Now why I have taken this thing in the current affairs, we will see. There was quite a fight between the ruling party and opposition parties regarding discussion with respect to Manipur violence. Okay, we will see that. So first is question hour. Now since we have to see that, we will see other also. So question hour was mentioned by Chawla Commission report. Okay, so they are mentioned in the procedures of rules and rules of Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, not in constitution. They are not mentioned in constitution. They are mentioned in the rules of governings of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. Then in case of question hour, if a person has to ask a question, he need to give a 15-day notice before asking such questions to the minister. Then there are some exceptions where the question hour, basically if when the house starts, it starts with question hour. Okay. It starts with question hour. So, but there are some exceptions wherein question hour may not be needed or is not applicable in those days. So what is the exception? For example, president address. President or governor's address is done generally after each general election. For example, after this general election, president's address will be there in June or July. Okay. In such cases, the address is given to the joint sitting, and in such cases, question hour is generally neglected, not taken into consideration. Similarly, after each year, each financial year, president address is going to happen. In those cases also, no need to have question hour. In case of budget session also, if budget has been presented, then also no need to require a question hour. Then there is a concept called star question. If a question is starred, then you need to have oral reply from the minister, and you can have a supplementary question in such cases. If a question is unstarred, that will be a written question, a written reply will be required, and in such cases there shall be no supplementary question. No supplementary question can be asked on a written reply. Okay. So these are some points here. Then in question hour, if a question has been asked by a member of parliament or minister, then the minister is bound to reply to such questions. Okay. So which questions are to be taken, not taken, that is to the discretion of the speaker. Generally questions are taken from different members, and then they are given to the ministers with a 15-day notice, and in such case minister is bound to reply. Okay. He is bound to reply. Minister is bound to reply compulsory to such question. Okay. May it be starred or unstarred, he has to reply. Then comes 0 hour. What is 0 hour? 0 hour is a type of question hour, you can say, but it is nowhere mentioned in the constitution, nowhere mentioned in the Lok Sabha rules or Rajya Sabha rules. It's an innovation of India itself. In such cases, question can be asked without giving any notice. Question can directly be asked, and minister is in such case is not bound to reply to that question, but it still stands a smaller value with respect to question hour. Okay. But still, if a minister is not able to answer such questions in 0 hour also, it sends a negative signal. So this also is very important. 0 hour, it happens generally after the question hour, and then the business of the day starts. So 0 hour, nowhere mentioned in the constitution, nowhere mentioned in the Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha rules, etc. There is no notice required to be given to the minister to whom you are to ask a question, and the minister is in such a way is not bound to reply to that question. Okay, so let us see few more. So there is one more thing called as half an hour discussion, which require a three day notice. That is not important. So what is important is that the fight which occurred between the opposition party and the ruling party regarding the discussion of Manipur issue. So what was the opposition saying? That we need to have longer discussion, we need to set aside all the businesses of the day and completely focus our discussion on the Manipur incident. Okay, the horrific incident that happened in Manipur. I think 1 hour, 1 year has been passed to that incident. So in that session of the parliament, there was conflict between the ruling party and the opposition party. So what was the opposition party saying? They wanted longer discussion by removing all the businesses of the day and we will talk only about this Manipur issue. What the ruling party was saying, that no, we will talk about the issue in shorter discussion, day by day, whenever required, that can be extended. That was the defense from the ruling party. But let us forget about the fight. What is the difference between such short duration discussion and the longer duration discussion? So basically, short duration discussion, this is mentioned in rule 176 of the Lok Sabha, okay, Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, rule 176. So what it says, it requires first of all a lesser notice than the question hour, only 10 day notice is enough, and there will be an oral reply from the minister, okay, 10 day notice, oral reply. Then reason is required. For example, if you need to invoke this legislative control of short duration discussion, you need to have a reason. Okay, then the discussion should be taking place at least 2.5 hours, 2.5 hours completely allocated for discussion of this topic which has been taken up under short duration discussion. And the member who will be applying for such short duration discussion need to have signature of himself plus two other members of the Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha, wherever this is being applied. Okay, so basically these are the few points which you need to know about short duration discussion. So lesser notice of 10 days, there will be oral reply from the government, then there has to be a reason before giving application for the short duration discussion, then discussion shall be occurring at least 2.5 hours on that particular topic, and signature of the applicant plus two members is required for getting this short duration discussion to be approved from the speaker. Speaker will only approve such discussions. Now in that case, the fight between the opposition and the ruling party was fine with this concept, this short duration discussion. The ruling party was fine with it. But the problem was, opposition party was demanding of the longer discussion, rule 267 of the Lok Sabha Rajya Sabha rules. Now what it said, rule 267, it requires a longer discussion. Means in such cases, the business of the day which has been listed for that day, businesses, all the listed bills, items, etc. for that day will be set aside and complete focus on the discussion of the issue to be discussed. So this is like an adjournment motion. We will see what is adjournment motion. But this can be used in both the house, unlike adjournment motion. Adjournment motion is used only in Rajya Sabha or only used in Lok Sabha, not in Rajya Sabha. Why? We will see. But for now, just understand this is a longer discussion, okay? Rule number 267. And business listed for the day will be suspended and complete focus on the urgent matter. So this was the fight. So what is now adjournment motion? Adjournment motion will be only regarding any urgent matter and those matter which have not been previously discussed, okay? On such matters, adjournment motion can be put forward. Then adjournment motion will require support of 50 members, signature of 50 members. It's an extraordinary device. That means it has some kind of censure against the government. Okay. So if that involves a censure against the government, and hence it is only applicable in Lok Sabha. It is, adjournment motion cannot be included in Rajya Sabha, because Rajya Sabha is a permanent house. And anything against the government, censoring of the government, will not be applicable in Rajya Sabha. It is only applicable in Lok Sabha. Again, here also discussion will take place in 230 hours. Adjournment motion will be ending with a voting. So if adjournment motion generally invoked by opposition parties, and if such motion is getting passed, then government is in danger, may resign. Okay, so hence, again, this is only applicable in Lok Sabha, not in Rajya Sabha. But in Rule 267, if this is getting approved, there is no harm to the government. Only the thing is that there will be a longer discussion. There is no requirement of 50 members support. Okay, only urgent matter will be required. It is not a censure against the government. Only thing is that the business of the day will be suspended. Everything else shall be focusing on the urgent matter itself, not the business of the day. So it is in a way similar to adjournment motion, but not exactly. Okay. Then there is no confidence motion. We all know what is no confidence motion. So if no confidence motion can be introduced in only in Lok Sabha, and if no confidence motion is introduced, it will be requiring again 50 member support, 50 members. If in inducing no confidence motion, there is no requirement of any reason. No reason is required. Okay. And once you have motion, we have applied a no confidence motion, then before 6 months, you cannot go for another no confidence motion. Okay. So there is a gap of 6 months which has to be maintained between two no confidence motions. So this is no confidence motion. We all know it. This is also not mentioned in constitution. Okay. So this is only applicable in Lok Sabha. Similarly, cut motion is also applicable in Lok Sabha only, because it is regarding the budget. For example, 1 day notice is given and this cut motion is approved by the speaker, Lok Sabha speaker. There are three types of cut motion. For example, disapproval policy cut. Then there is economy cut and token cut. So basically, cut motion is again introduced by the opposition party. If the complete policy has to be rejected by the opposition party, then they will go on to have a disapproval policy cut. If this is passed, government will resign. Okay. Economy cut. Now here the opposition party can request certain policy, for example, fund allocated to certain policy to be reduced. Okay. So basically cut the policy. That can be addressed by the government. Government can think of that. Token cut again, for example, amount to be reduced by ₹100. Just a gesture, to show grievance to the policy that the opposition is not happy with the policy. This is not important. The thing, important thing is that here, those are highlighted in blue. No confidence, cut motion and adjournment motion will require voting and only available in Lok Sabha. Other legislative control that we talked about, they can take place in Lok Sabha as well as Rajya Sabha, and there is no need of voting at the end. Okay. So these are the legislative controls. Then we'll see what next. 10th schedule. Okay. So this is also interesting topic which is continuously in news. So we have seen disqualification in our general most probable classes, okay, during Union Parliament. How the disqualification will take place? Via one way. There are two ways of disqualification. 1011 and 1911. So two ways of disqualification. Disqualification can occur in two ways. Either we have seen the first way in our previous classes. It is done by President or Governor on the suggestion of Election Commission of India. Now, what are the grounds for removal of this disqualification? On this is the grounds are, for example, he is a undischarged insolvent, not a citizen of India, then unsound mind, and any other act that the government has passed to maintain the eligibility. If it has the member has not disqualified according to that act, then also he will be disqualified by President or Governor. But there is another way through which disqualification can take place, that is Article 1021 and 1912. This is should be 2. Okay. So this is 10th schedule disqualification. 10th schedule disqualification. This disqualification, this is done by President Governor. This disqualification is approved by Speaker or Chairman. Speaker or Chairman. Okay. It's in his discretion. So let us see. So the 10th schedule was introduced in 52nd Constitutional Amendment Act 1985. What it said that if what is disqualification for? For example, if in a political party, few members are being switching sides, they are not listening to the whip, they are not voting according to direction given by the whip of the party, then they can be disqualified. So in such cases, there was no law regarding those things. So there had been a case in Haryana, I guess, that a member of a political party switched sides 3 times in a single day. They were called as Ayaram Gayaram. That's why this 10th schedule was introduced in 1985, and it said that if there is a split in a party and one third of its members, that is split of one third of the members of party, if more than one third members are not in concurrence with the party, then they can merge into different party, and this is allowed. So basically, if less than one third of the members, if a party has legislators, for example 30 legislators, then at least 11 members need to get split away from the party, then only they are not eligible for disqualification. Otherwise, if nine members split from the party, then they are eligible for disqualification and speaker can disqualify them. This was the case in 1985, but still the disqualification, the Ayaram Gayaram process didn't stop. So the government came up with another thing, 91st Constitution Amendment Act. In this, it said at least 2/3 of the members need to be switch overing to and merge into another political party. Okay, then these members are safe from disqualification. If these members are less than 2/3, then they are also disqualified. Okay, so that was condition added in 91st Constitutional Amendment Act. So now the 1/3 split is gone. Now at least 2/3 members are to be taken away from the political party and get merged into another political party. Okay, so that is the way they can be saved from disqualification. Otherwise, they are disqualified. So if less than 2/3 members are splitting away from the party, they will get disqualified. For example, the 30 members legislators are there, then even if 16 members split away from the party, they will get disqualified, because the number has to be more than 2/3, that is more than 20 members. Okay, so request will go to speaker and he will disqualify. There is no suo moto clause for speaker to take up the decision, to take up the issue on its own. A issue has to be provided to speaker, then only he will take decision on the disqualification. So one more thing in the 10th schedule is that it gives constitutional recognition to political parties. This is the first case in which constitutional recognition is provided to political parties. Then what are the grounds of disqualification under this act? We have seen, against the direction of whip. Whip is, means you can say, a member who is appointed by the political party to look upon the businesses of in the house with respect to that political party. Okay, and he will be the in charge of all those businesses. So it is a whip. So whip will provide direction of, to be, for example, members are to be present today, means what whip can issue directions on. For example, presenting whip can issue direction that all the members should be present today. Okay, then he can issue direction on voting, that all the members have to vote today. Or he can say all the members have to vote in a particular way, yes or no. Okay, so basically whip can give directions. If a member is acting against the direction of whip, for example, whip is asking a member to be present in the house in his absence, asking him to vote in a certain direction, he is voting in some other ways, or abstaining from voting, then action can be taken and he can be disqualified. Then I have already told you 1/3 split was allowed, but in 52nd, but this is not applicable now. Minimum 2/3 of the chunk of the political party has to be shifted and merged into another political party, then only they can be saved from disqualification. Then another way of disqualification is, for example, a nominated member either by governor or the president in the as per the case may be. So if a nominated member joins a political party after 6 months after getting nominated, for example, recently Ms. Sudha Murthy was nominated in Rajya Sabha. Now if such a member joins a particular political party after 6 months of such nomination, then that member will be disqualified, eligible for disqualification. Okay. So if a nominated member has to join a political party, he has to join within 6 months after getting nominated, otherwise he will be disqualified. He or she will be disqualified. Independent member. What is an independent member? independently getting elected, not backed by any political party. If such a member joins any political party after election, he will be disqualified. So basically, for the complete term, independent member has to remain independent. He cannot join any political party. Okay, he has to remain independent. He cannot join any political party. If he joins, he will be eligible for disqualification. Then there is some exceptions. For example, presiding officers, speaker, for example, say speaker, deputy speaker, they are exception under 10th schedule. What they can do? For example, we will say speaker or the deputy speaker, the presiding officers for a Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, need to be more neutral in approach. Okay, they cannot be partisan in any ways. They need not lean towards any political party. They need to be neutral. So for them, exception here is given that they can resign from their political party for the period of their appointment of presiding officer, and then they can rejoin the political party after they have done their appointment. Okay, so exception is given to the presiding officers. One or the speaker will disqualify such member. Courts cannot intervene in disqualification matters until speaker has taken any decision. After speaker has taken a decision, then you can move to Supreme Court regarding such decision. Then Supreme Court can discuss upon it. Okay. So why? What is it news? Because the things that happened in Maharashtra. So before going into the Maharashtra case, we'll see. Actually, the petition was filed against the 10th schedule in Supreme Court way back in 1990s, and Kyoto Holwan case upheld 10th schedule. No, it is right. It is required. Manipur case. There was again a thing that here, if a disqualification petition goes to a speaker, okay, and speaker just keep that thing under this table and no decision is taken for long number of days, any number of days, then the whole point of this disqualification procedure will be get defended. Okay, so basically, to improve this procedure, Supreme Court suggested that the speaker has to take decision on disqualification within 3 months. Otherwise, all the purpose of the disqualification process will get repeated. So, speaker need to be taking decision within 3 months. As per Manipur case, it is just advisory, not a rule. So what's the matter in Maharashtra? So the case was Subhash Desai versus Government of Maharashtra 2023. There are few things that Supreme Court has noted down. You should be knowing it. So whip. So there are some statements that Supreme Court has directly given in terms of whip. So whip is a link between political party and the legislative party. Okay. So Supreme Court has said that there are two things for a political party. There is a political party, for example, office bearers in the political party, the president of the party, the vice president, chairman, then committees of various committees of the parties, then district level party hierarchy, division level party hierarchy, state level hierarchy, national level hierarchy. Those are the political parties which are not in the legislature. But the legislators, the MLAs, MPs of such party is called as legislative party. Okay. So who will be the link between the political party and legislative party? It will be the whip. Okay. And that whip will be appointed by whom? By political party and not the legislative party. So the legislators cannot appoint a whip. Who will appoint a whip? The political party. And the leader of the party in the legislature, every legislative party, whether it be in Vidhan Sabha or in parliament, there is a leader of the party in the legislature, leader of this legislative party. Who will appoint him? He or she will be appointed by the political party. So these are few statements made by the Supreme Court. Now, the problem in Maharashtra case was, as you know, Mr. Eknath Shinde, he has now 40 MLAs with him. Now, Shiv Sena comprised of, I think, 56 MLAs. Okay. Now, he had, Mr. Eknath Shinde, Honorable Chief Minister of Maharashtra, now has 40 MLAs with him. This is more than two-thirds. Okay. This is more than two-thirds. So, basically, he skipped the disqualification process. But what the disqualification process said that the members who are outside, who are splitting from the party, should be merging in another party. Otherwise, they will be disqualified, right? Otherwise, they will be disqualified. So, the thing is that these members did not merge in any of the political party. They remained as it is and claimed that the original Shiv Sena is their Shiv Sena. So that was their claim against the Uddhav Thackeray faction of the party. So this was, you can say, a bypass that they have found to not get disqualified and also save their own party and need not to merge in any other party. So that was the thing here. Now, disqualification, why is the fear of disqualification? Fear of disqualification is because if a person gets disqualified, he cannot be a minister in the same house. He has to be, the seat will be remain vacant and he has to get elected from the people in the house, and then he can only become minister. So that's the main crux here. So if he cannot become minister, why will he want to get disqualified by himself? Okay, he need to run the election once again, get into house, then only he can become minister. So they found a way that, okay, we will skip the disqualification by getting 2/3 MLAs and claiming the party. So that was their claim. So the complete thing, the split in the party went into Election Commission of India, and that thing went into Supreme Court. So problem was that the each section, for example, the UBT section, Uddhav Balasaheb Thackeray section, and the Shinde section, they had their own claim on the whip. This said that we have appointed our whip, and he said that we have appointed our whip. So whose direction needs to be taken by the members? That was the question. Okay, so basically whip provided by both of them, that was the complete confusion in it, and hence the Supreme Court said that whip is a link between political and legislative party, and he is appointed by the political party. Okay, now problem is, which is the political party? Now whether Shiv Sena UBT is a political party or Shiv Sena Shinde is a political party, that also is in question, was in question. Okay, so what did the Supreme Court said? The leader of the the identification of the political party and the whip, identification of political party and the whip will be done by the speaker himself. So speaker will decide which is the political party, whether this is a political party or this is a political party. Speaker will decide, and subsequently he will decide which whip is correct. Okay, basically on the political, based on the political party. So that decision was recently given by the Honorable Speaker of Maharashtra Assembly, and according to him, the Shiv Sena of Shinde faction was a political party and their whip was the correct whip. So that was the case. Supreme Court asked to determine the political party and the whip to the speaker. Now after getting the decision from the speaker, now the opposition or the UBT section went into Supreme Court. Okay, regarding this, so for the, now when the party split took place, the both the parties went to the Election Commission of India. You know, Election Commission of India has a quasi-judicial power also. They can discuss upon the split of the party, which party is the correct party for the political party among the two. So they came up with a triple test. What is the triple test? First is ideology. Who is following the ideology of the party? This section is following or that section is following? One thing. Then office bearers of the political party. For example, the president of the national party, president of the state unit of the party, president of the district unit of the party, then its hierarchy, okay, subdivisional, complete hierarchy of the political party. So office bearers. Now office bearers are with whom? The UPT section or the Shinde section? So this was the another thing. This is test one. Who is following the ideology? Who has more office bearers? Test two. And who has more number of legislature? Okay. So who has more number of MLAs and who had more number of MPs? This was the third. So this is called as triple test. So basically Election Commission said that this cannot be determined since both are claiming that we have followed our ideology. This also cannot be determined because there is no time to check each and every possible, no time to check each and every possible submission given to ECI. And the last one is the number of legislatures. This was the only thing that the Election Commission can calculate, and hence on the basis of the number of legislators, as we know, more number of MLAs, more number of MPs was with Mr. Shinde. So ECI decided that the political party will be the Shinde Sena, or the now it called the Shiv Sena. Okay, so this is a discussion about 10th schedule. That's why it was in news. Okay, so just a second, I will take a 2-minute break. Okay, so sorry for the delay. So we were on 10th schedule and we have completed it. Let us move on to Representation of People Act. So as we know, we are approaching Lok Sabha election, so this becomes important. So Representation of People Act 1950 and 1951, these are the two important acts. 1950 talks about allocation and breakup. For example, allocation of breakup in seats of Lok Sabha, in seats of Vidhan Sabha and in seats of Vidhan Parishad. That is, this is mentioned in Schedule 1 of the Act, this is mentioned in Schedule 2 of the Act, and this is mentioned in Schedule 3 of the Act. Breakup in Lok Sabha, breakup in Vidhan Sabha and breakup in the Vidhan Parishad, or we call them MLCs, okay? So allocation breakup given in these three schedules of the Act. Then what else? Preparation of electoral roll, it is under Representation of People Act 1950. Then the registration of electors, we as the elector, we get registered under this act and 1950 act. Then this act gives president power to delimit. What is delimit? Delimitation is delimiting the territory. For example, delimitation of Vidhan Sabha, delimitation of the Lok Sabha constituency. So this act gives president power to delimit. Then appointments done by ECI, Election Commission of India does appointments. For example, district election officer, chief election officer, returning officer, etc. These are all appointments are done under this act. Then disqualification for being in electoral roll. So there are few conditions in which you can be disqualified being an elector. For example, if you have got citizenship by fraud, or you have not abided by the constitution, there are few things under which you can get disqualified for being in an electoral roll. So disqualification for being an electoral roll is under 1950 act. Then who will vote? Basically electors. Regarding whatever is mentioned regarding the electors, we as an elector, everything is mentioned in article or mentioned in the act of 1950. How to vote, for example, EVM, or to vote through postal ballots, proxy voting, etc. to certain category of people, for example, the people from military or people from who are involved in government duties during elections, they need to vote by postal ballots. So that thing is also mentioned in this act. Then almost everything with respect to electors is mentioned in this 1950 act. What is mentioned in 1951 act is conditions for disqualification of the candidate. So this has, we have already seen disqualification, the first way of disqualification. This act comes up and there are few conditions wherein member of the parliament or Vidhan Sabha can get disqualified. For example, if he gets acquitted in a case for more than 2 years, then he will get disqualified for that 2 plus 6 years. He cannot contest election for 6 years. Then if he has not published his expenditure within 30 days, then also you can get disqualified. Then some grievous offenses he has done, then also he can get disqualified. For example, against women, children, dowry, then incitement of violence, etc. There are certain more conditions under which he can get disqualified. Then conduct of election, how the election would be conducted by the election commissioner, will be also again under the 1951 Act. Okay. Then disputes. For example, election petition has to be filed that this member has been illegally, or there is a dispute in election of such person, then election petition has to be filed within 45 days. This condition also mentioned in this act. Then Rajya Sabha related issues, for example, Rajya Sabha election member has a term of 6 years. This is not mentioned in constitution, this is mentioned in this act. Then Rajya Sabha election is to be, there is no nota condition in Rajya Sabha. For example, nota option is not available in the Rajya Sabha. Further, whip, application of whip. Whip, mandatory approval of a whip will not be required in Rajya Sabha election. You can vote against the direction of whip also. There is no nota. These are all mentioned in the Representation of People Act 1951. Then registration of political parties. Political parties are to be registered under this act with Election Commission of India. Okay. So there are few criteria. For example, all the members are to be citizen of India. Then the purpose of the party should be only to take participate in elections, okay, not anything else. So there are few conditions. So registration of political parties under this act, then conduct of by-election. For example, this under this act it mentions that if a seat is vacant, then you need to have by-elections on it, but if only 1 year is left, 1 year is left for a general election, then that seat might not require any by-election. That is also mentioned in the Representation of People Act. Then eligibility of candidate. Eligibility of candidate to be eligible to stand in election. That is also mentioned in this act. For example, he has to be on electoral roll. He has to be elected in some of the constituency of the country to stand for election in Lok Sabha or Vidhan Sabha. That is one. That is the eligibility criteria mentioned in this act. So everything related to election and the candidate is mentioned in this act, and almost everything related to the electors, we the electors, as mentioned in this act. Okay, so let us move further. So the new thing that has been introduced recently is Bharatiya Nyaya Sanhita. So the main objective of this act is to replace the age old acts of the which were introduced at the time of the British. So first is, the most important thing is Bharatiya Nyaya Sanhita, BNS, which replaces the Indian Penal Code. So what is the additions in this, and what are the differences from the IPC, we will see. So Bharatiya Nyaya Sanhita, it adds new types of offenses. For example, first time in a criminal offense we have added a crime called as organized crime. This was not there earlier. This is added first time. So what is the organized crime? Any crime carried on behalf of a syndicate or a group of people committing any crime, that is called as organized crime, and that can lead to punishment of life imprisonment and even death. Then terrorism. Now terrorism first time has been included in this general act. Generally terrorism, there are different acts for terrorism, but IPC doesn't have terrorism in it. Now we have added terrorism in the BNS, that is Bharatiya Nyaya Sanhita, the General Act. Earlier it was held by the UAPA. So now the terrorism will, any action related to terrorism will take place with the help of BNS and UAPA. They will work in tandem with each other. And the meaning of terrorism in BNS will have a broader sense than the UAPA. UAPA has a narrower sense of terrorism. This will create a broader meaning of terrorism, and it may lead to punishment of life or death, up to death. Then another new offense that has been added here is mob lynching. Mob lynching means, again, this is an action done by a group. Murder or grievously hurt, a person if he is being murdered or grievously hurt by a group of five or more on grounds of race, caste, sex, language or personal belief, then such act is called as mob lynching. They have defined mob lynching that if murder or grievous hurt to a person by a group of five or more on these grounds can lead to punishment of life imprisonment or even death. Okay. Then Bharatiya Nyaya Sanhita also adds community service as a punishment. So one has to do some community services if he has been punished for these three items. Community services, for example, cleaning, gardening, etc. The community service that we all know. So, for example, if he has been accused for or convicted in case of a theft of less than 5,000 rupees, attempt to suicide, restrain a public officer from his duties, then any public annoyance. Okay, for example, after getting drunk, he has been creating public nuisance. Then also, community service can be act as a punishment. Then offense against women, there are some changes here. So till now rape law was applicable to women, only applicable to women. Now also rape law is only applicable to women only. The only thing that they have changed is that the victim to be called as a major. Earlier victim was called as a major if she has crossed 16 years of age. Now this has moved to 18 years of age. Okay. So now victim will be called as a major only after 18 years of age and not 16. So even if you know a crime committed against a minor will incur higher punishment. Hence this age limit has been increased. So this will be a more stringent law now. Okay. Because the definition of a major has been increased to 18 years. Then rape law still applicable only for the woman. Then procuration of a minor made general neutral. Now procuration of minor means, now if procuration of person less than 18 years means kidnapping, sexual harassment of a person, if it is less than 18 years, then that will be a gender neutral thing. Okay, then it need not be a female only. Then there are some deletions, some acts which have been deleted. For example, unnatural sexual offense, which has been deleted by the Supreme Court itself, homosexuality, etc. Then adultery, example, extramarital affairs, etc., that is also been deleted. Then seditions mean sedition was deleted, but there are few things which are now under the act. They have been acting as sedition, but on paper sedition is eliminated. Okay, if you read the act, punishment are given to certain things which are similar to seditions, but the act in overall sense says that it has deleted sedition. So we will confirm as sedition is being deleted. Then further is act of criminal responsibility. Age of criminal responsibility is retained at 7 years. So in IPC also it was 7 and here also it is 7. In certain cases this may increase up to 12 years. So age of criminal responsibility means if a person who is less than 7 years of age, then it is considered that he is incapable of committing any crime. So basically he will not be punished. His guardian or parents may be punished, but he will not be punished. He or she will not be punished. So this criminal responsibility age is retained at 7 years in India. So this is less than what the UN committee has suggested. UN committee suggested 12 years to be the ideal criminal responsibility age. Then Bharatiya Nagarik Suraksha Sanhita, BNSS. Now this has replaced CRPC. This is a procedural code. IPC was a substantive code. This is a procedural code. Detention under a trial. Now if there is trial going on, for example, a person generally is treated as an accused. He is not a convict. He is treated as an accused. Basically, he is innocent until proven guilty. Now if he has been arrested and put under detention and trial is going on, now under trial if he has spent half of his sentence, then he need to be released on bail or bond. That is one thing that has been added under this BNSS. Then all trials inquiry proceedings can be held by electronic mode. This is one thing that has been added. Then trial judgment can be pronounced in absence of an offender. If an offender is absconding, then also trial can take place. Then Bharatiya Sakshya Bill, that is it replaces the Indian Evidence Act. Now the main act is भारतीय न्याय संहिता, दीज आर द कॉम्प्लीमेंट्री एक्ट, जस्ट हैव सम आइडिया. सो इट रिप्लेसेस इंडियन एविडेंस एक्ट, एड्स इलेक्ट्रॉनिक एविडेंसेज एज प्राइमरी एविडेंस. प्रीवियसली इलेक्ट्रॉनिक एविडेंसेज वेयर सेकेंडरी एविडेंस, नाउ इलेक्ट्रॉनिक एविडेंस आर एक्टिंग एज अ प्राइमरी एविडेंस. देन जॉइंट ट्रायल, इवन वन ऑफ द अक्यूज इज अब्सकॉन्डिंग, इट विल बी कंसिडर्ड जॉइंट ट्रायल. सो जॉइंट ट्रायल वॉज प्रेजेंट बिफोर ऑल्सो, बट नाउ इफ if one of the accused is absconding, then also the trial will be conducted as a joint trial. Then we'll come to electoral bond. So as you know, electoral bond was introduced by previous government, that is of course the Modi government, but the previous, before 2019, in 2017-2018 the electoral bond scheme was launched. The main aim was to curb the black money. For example, previously parties would get funding from various ways, but that was not listed anywhere. Now electoral bond scheme is that parties need to be funded only through electoral bonds, which are to be purchased by electoral bonds can be purchased by anyone, a company, individual, anyone in a specific branch of State Bank of India, SBI, okay, and that can be donated to political party. Now the clause here was of anonymity. The person who is purchasing electoral bond knows where he is donating the electoral bond, into which party he is donating, but the party will not know from whom the electoral bond is being encashed. So basically that was the complete thing. So but now SBI has all the information. Now SBI is a public sector undertaking, so indirectly government has control over the SBI, and government can know from where the electoral bonds are being purchased, who is purchasing electoral bond, who is donating to the ruling party, who is donating to the opposition party. Everything can be known, because the condition was that SBI will only give the electoral bonds, and SBI is a public sector undertaking. So if you know the electoral bond has a alphanumeric number from which we can directly say that from because it has been quashed by the Supreme Court, it is now illegal, unconstitutional, okay. So need not to go in detail of the electoral bonds. So but what are the Supreme Court findings? So the first finding was that electoral bond was violation of RTI Act under 19(1)(a). So 19(1)(a), freedom of speech and expression, under which Right to Information Act was passed in 2005. So electoral bond was kept out of the RTI. So if you want to know which electoral bond was purchased by whom and which political party encashed it, we could not know it because it was outside the RTI Act. Then the Supreme Court said every person has a right to know that who has been funding a political party, to whom he is going to vote. So that is out of question, that this cannot be exempted from RTI Act. So this is the violation of RTI Act, and according to Supreme Court. Supreme Court also said that economic inequality contributes to political inequality. That means quid pro quo. What is a quid pro quo? Now there was condition in electoral bond that even if a company, if it is not in profit, it is loss making company, still it can give electoral bonds to the parties. Now if you check few of the companies that have given the electoral bonds, you can see that there are few companies who has purchased electoral bond many times more than what their profit shows, okay. So basically no company will give their electoral bonds, will donate electoral bonds to a party without getting anything in return. So Supreme Court clearly said that without quid pro quo, companies will never give money to any political party. Hence this electoral bond scheme has to be under RTI Act, and Supreme Court asked SBI to furnish all its details and give it to Election Commission of India. So this was the first thing, that is, it is violating RTI Act. Then the defense from the government was that this act was brought to curb the black money, but to curb the black money means what can be done? For example, 19(1)(a) is freedom of speech and expression. Under this there is RTI Act. So RTI Act exemption can be made only through article, exemption can be made only through Article 19.2. What Article 19.2 says? That this is not an absolute right, there are some reasonable restrictions. What are the reasonable restrictions? Security of the nation, friendly relations, then defamation, incitement of violence, public safety, decency, morality, etc. But nowhere it mentions that black money is also one of the restrictions on 19.1a. Hence, Supreme Court clearly said that RTI cannot be restricted under 19.2, because black money cannot be restricted under 19.2. Hence, RTI also cannot be restricted. So that was the thing under Supreme Court. And Supreme Court said that if you need to curb black money, go for a less restrictive option. This is a more restrictive option. You are restricting the complete right to information to public. You cannot do that. Go for a less restrictive option. Then proportionality test. So proportionality test was first used in Puttuswamy case while giving the judgment of privacy. Privacy was introduced in Article 21, right to life. So there proportionality test was used. Now what it says? Proportionality test, there are three conditions. For example, first is there has to be an existence of a law. Okay, now electoral bond was brought by a law, finance act. So there is a law, fine. Then next thing is that there shall be legitimate state interest. Now what was the state interest? At least on paper it was to curb black money. Now already this defense of the government was struck down by the court in this second point, that need to go for a less restrictive option, and black money cannot be a reasonable restriction under Article 19.1a. So the government was on back foot on this part. Then now, is encroachment of Article 9.1a is a proportional to the objective? Means whatever is your concerned act, that has to be proportional to your objective. Objective is curbing black money, and what are you encroaching upon? 19.1a. So is it proportional? So even in this case, Supreme Court say it is not proportional. So basically the act failed on proportionality test also. So the discussion mainly here is there are two fundamental rights which are at play. First is Article 19.1a, RTI Act, right to information. Okay, so individual has a right to information regarding every electoral bond as per Supreme Court, versus Article 21, that is right to privacy. Privacy of whom? Of all the individuals and all the companies who have donated electoral bonds. Okay, so these two fundamental rights are in fight now. What to save? If you save the privacy of the individual and the company, this will get affected, right to information. If you save right to information and all the electoral bonds are brought in public, then this privacy clause will get affected. So one of the two things has to be solved by the Supreme Court. So in such cases, we need a balancing act. So what are the previous cases of Supreme Court in such cases? Supreme Court has constantly said that public interest is always above individual interest. Okay, so public interest, what is the public interest here? Public interest is right to information. Right to information is a public interest, while privacy here is that's a private interest. Okay, individual interest, individual company interest, individual member interest. So what is important? Public interest will take a superior position than the private interest or the individual interest. Hence Article 19a prevailed over Article 21 in this condition. So public interest is over private individual fundamental right. So on this front also the act was nullified. Then again the Supreme Court said that unlimited political contribution by companies is unconstitutional. That is also fine, because ability of company and ability of individual to influence political process is different. Individual can give up to a certain amount, company can give up to a large amount. An unlimited political contribution can lead to quid pro quo situation. Okay, so means giving political donation, getting some advantages in other ways. So that is also one condition that Supreme Court said is unconstitutional. So this is the discussion about electoral bonds. You need not to go in details about how the electoral bonds were purchased, what is the procedure, because now it has been struck down. And related PMLA Act. So Enforcement Directorate, this is a non-constitutional body. non-constitutional body. Okay. It is under Department of Revenue, Ministry of Finance. It is under Ministry of Finance, under Department of Revenue. Director of the ED is appointed by the central government directly. And extension can be given 1 year at a time, but the director cannot stay in the office beyond 5 years. 5 years is the limit. So, the complete discussion is around this PMLA Act, functions of Enforcement Directorate. Enforcement Directorate's main function is application of PMLA Act, Prevention of Money Laundering Act, PMLA Act 2002. So, this act was introduced based on commitment given to Vienna Convention on to combat money laundering. So, India signed Vienna Convention to combat money laundering, and to give effect to that convention, we introduced Prevention of Money Laundering Act 2002. So, under this act, a special court is assigned, allotted. For example, a session court in the district is allotted as a special court by the central government after consultation with CJHC of that particular state, of that particular high court, chief justice of that particular high court. Central government will provide a special court among the sessions court with consultation with chief justice of that particular high court. Now, what ED can do under this act, if a person is accused under money laundering under this act, then what is money laundering? Laundering, for you know, laundry, where you wash your clothes. So basically, black money converted into white money is called as money laundering, laundering of a money. We will not go into details. But if a person is accused under money laundering act, then enforcement directed can attach, seize, search his property without any warrant. No need of warrant. He can be arrested without warrant. Can seize properties. Okay, the ECIR copy, that is the first, this is as good as the FIR copy from the police station. But in case of FIR copy of police station, you have a right to get a copy of FIR also. But this ECIR copy is an internal document of enforcement director. This need not to be taken in public. This need not to be given to the accused. This is internal document. So basically, we don't know for what he has been taken into custody. Then confessions made in front of enforcement direct officer will be considered in the court. This is unlike what the confessions made under police custody cannot be taken into court, but confessions made under ED officer, because they are not police officers, they can be considered in the court. Then accused person has burden to prove his innocence. So in most of the cases in India, a person is innocent until proven guilty. But in this case, a person is guilty until he is proven innocent. Okay, so basically the burden to prove his or her innocence in this case lies with the person himself. Okay, so basically whenever he is put under trial, he will be treated as a guilty person. Now it's his responsibility to prove his innocence. Now recently GST network has also been put under PMLA Act because of various frauds mentioned in GST, took place in GST. Okay, that is not important, but the thing is that many of these considerations are being upheld by Supreme Court. Hence, Enforcement Director in today's condition is quite a powerful organization, because they do not need the warrant, they do not need to share the FIR copy or the ECIR copy with the accused. They can directly arrest them. Okay, and now there are also problems with the bails. For example, if a person, this is a section 45 of the act, which says that the act is cognizable and non-bailable. What is cognizable? Means the officer of the enforcement director on his own cognizance can arrest any person. They do not require permission from a district magistrate to arrest anyone. They can arrest on their own. They can take cognizance on their own. And it is a non-bailable offense. The bail can be given only in two conditions. If the court is satisfied that prima facie he or she is not guilty. Now basically the act itself says that a person who is arrested will be treated as guilty. So this is quite a rare situation that court will hardly ever say that prima facie he or she is not guilty. And again, one more thing is that the person should not likely to be committing any offense while he or she is on bail. So basically, because of these two conditions, getting bail under PMLA Act becomes quite difficult thing. If you know many of the cases under PMLA Act, for example, the Manish Sisodia case, he is still under arrest since 1 year. He is not getting bail. Other functions of Enforcement Directorate, they also take part in proceedings under FEMA Act, under FEO Act, that is Fugitive Economic Offenders Act, then sponsoring agency under Coffee Pesa Act. This is Preventive Detention Act. Basically, the main application is PMLA Act. You need to focus on this. So that is regarding Enforcement Directorate. Then comes Parliamentary Committees. So the Parliamentary Committee, which was in news, was this Ethics Committee. If you know regarding the Trinamool Congress Member of Parliament, Ms. Muva Moitra, she was called in front of Ethics Committee, and there was some conflict in it. Okay, so we'll see about Ethics Committee, but first of all, let us see what are the other committees, other Parliamentary Committees. There are three important: Financial Committees, Public Account Committee, Estimate Committee, and the Committee on Public Undertakings. So Public Account Committee, this committee, this will look after the CAG report. Okay, postmortem of the CAG report. CAG will give all the audit reports of all the government accounts, and postmortem of that CAG report is done by the Public Account Committee. This committee consists of 22 members, 15 from Lok Sabha, 7 from Rajya Sabha. They are elected by indirect elections, that is single transferable vote and proportional representation. Indirect election, they are elected. Then the chairman and member are appointed by the speaker, but chairman is from opposition party. This is not a rule, but by convention, chairman is from opposition party. Then there shall be no minister in this committee. Then 1 year term, every member is there for a year term. Estimate committee consists of, what is Estimate Committee? It does now, since Public Account Committee, this does the postmortem of CAG report. Estimate Committee will do discussion on budget. Okay, budget. This is a 30 member committee, and every member is from Lok Sabha itself. No Rajya Sabha member in it. Estimate Committee, and chairman is from ruling party. This is again a convention, not a rule. Okay, again 1 year term. There shall be a no minister in this committee, and elected by single transferable vote, proportional representation. Then last one is Committee on Public Undertaking. These are the three financial committees. Public Undertaking means committee on which will focus on the audit reports of the PSUs, public sector undertaking, etc. Again, this case also, there are 22 members, 15 from Lok Sabha, 7 from Rajya Sabha. Similar way of getting elected, 1 year term again. Then no minister again. Only thing is the chairman here. Chairman is appointed by the speaker from Lok Sabha members. Chairman is from Lok Sabha members. Members are there from both Lok Sabha as well as Rajya Sabha, but the chairman is only from the Lok Sabha. Okay, so that's one thing. Then there are departmental standing committees. Departmental standing committees, these are for advisory committees for various acts of the various act policies of the government. For example, in case of budget session, various provisions of the budget before getting voted in the parliament, they are given under departmental standing committee. They scrutinize upon them. So there are 24 departmental standing committees. 16 are from Lok Sabha and 8 are from Rajya Sabha. Each committee has 31 members. Okay. Both from Lok Sabha as well as from Rajya Sabha. Okay, so each committee has 31 members, both from Lok Sabha as well as Rajya Sabha. That is 21 from Lok Sabha and 10 from Rajya Sabha. Again, this committee will not have a member or minister, only 1 year term, and everyone is nominated here. No one is elected, everyone is nominated. So that is Departmental Standing Committee. Then Committees on Welfare of SC, then Committee on Welfare of ST and Committee on Welfare on Women. These are three different committees. These are again 30 member committees, 20 from Lok Sabha, 10 from Rajya Sabha, and they will submit their report to the respective chairman or speaker. Then further, there are Business Advisory Committee, Rules Committee, General Purpose Committee, how the business of the house will go, rules of the Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, general purpose of the, basically these are all the rules committee. These are present in both Lok Sabha as well as Rajya Sabha, and their chairman of this committee is the ex officio chairman of the house, ex officio chairman of that house. Okay, for example, Business Advisory Committee, in Lok Sabha chairman is speaker, in Rajya Sabha chairman is the vice president, the chairman of the house. Okay, similarly rules committee and similar general purpose committee. Now, ethics committee and the privilege committee. So let us see what is ethics committee. So both ethics committee and privilege committee are in Lok Sabha as well as in Rajya Sabha. Ethics committee in both the houses oversee what it does. It oversees the moral and ethical conduct of the person. If the ethical conduct or morality of the person is not proper, then a member can file a complaint against a legislator to the speaker regarding this committee. Okay, so it can be filed by a member, or it can, suo motu can be filed by the speaker himself. Okay, so basically if ethical conduct is wrong, then member against that particular member will file a complaint to the speaker. Speaker himself can file a complaint against that member. Now, these have some similarity with the Privilege Committee. Privilege Committee also does the same thing, but Ethics Committee will do those things in a less serious allegations. For example, if there are more severe allegations against a member, then that complaint will go to Privilege Committee and not Ethics Committee. So that is the difference. And complaints only against members. For in Ethics Committee complaint can only be against the members of the parliament. In Privileges Committee, complaint can be against member as well as those who are not member of the house. Okay, Privileges Committee can issue complaint against both members as well as non-members, but Ethics Committee only against the members. So this you should know, because it was in news. Then say there are certain doctrines which Supreme Court has used. For example, doctrine of pith and substance. So generally Supreme Court use the doctrines to maintain the viability of the law, any law passed by parliament or by the state legislature. So in case of this pith and substance, this doctrine is used to distribute subjects to state list, concurrent list and union list. So what is this pith and substance? Is that in Shankari Prasad versus Union of India case, this pith and substance was elaborated by the Supreme Court. What it said, to validate any legislation enacted by union or the state legislature. For example, this doctrine will be used to validate any act, law beyond true nature of the act, true nature or the character of the legislation. Okay, so basically what is the legislation for? True nature of the legislation and not the incidental effect. It may have some incidental effect. For example, a law in a state which may be true in its nature and character, but it has some implication on, it may cross jurisdiction of the state and go in the union jurisdiction, but still it is not void, it is still there. That is called as pith and substance. Main thing is true nature and character of the jurisdiction and not its incidental effects. Okay, so if a law or legislation is correct regarding its nature and character of the legislation, then it is valid, the act is valid, even if it has some incidental effect on some other things. Okay, for example in case of BSNL versus Union of India case, what happened? This case was, petition was against the TRAI Act, the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India Act was passed, and petition was filed against the TRAI Act. So what the Supreme Court said that the TRAI Act, the what is the nature character, is to regulate telecom sector. So TRAI Act was to regulate telecom sector. So nature character was, legislation was right, but it had some incidental effect on whom? on share of revenue. Share of revenue between center and state. So basically there might be some mismatch in share, in the revenue share from the telecom sector into the states. So basically this petition was from the state governments itself. Basically they feared that their share of revenue will get reduced because of this act. But Supreme Court said that the nature or the character of the legislation is to regulate the telecom sector, which is important, which is correct. And it incidental effect is that it may affect the share of the revenue to the states. But that's not a problem. The act is fine, valid. Okay. So that is called as pith and substance. Then doctrine of transformative constitutionalism. Transformative constitutionalism means, again, Supreme Court says that law or the act should be in consonant, in concurrence with the present day, the present day environment. For example, Supreme Court struck down adultery, Supreme Court struck down homosexuality, means homosexuality is not a crime now. That is based on the present condition, present social condition of the public. So basically this doctrine was again used in MTP Act, that is Medical Termination of Pregnancy Act. Basically the act discriminated between two sections of the female, for example married women and unmarried women. The Medical Termination of Pregnancy Act was applicable only to married women and not to unmarried women. Hence Supreme Court came with the doctrine of constitutionalism, that you should be more and more proactive, or the act should be such that it should maintain pace of the social advancement of the public. Then doctrine of harmonious construct. Now this will be applicable only when there is a paradox, or in the same law there are some provisions which are contradictory to each other, or example in a state law or union law are contradictory to each other, then Supreme Court will introduce harmonious construct, doctrine of harmonious construct, to settle for the correct explanation. Then doctrine of territorial nexus. This will determine the jurisdiction of the law, till what the law has jurisdiction. Okay. Then doctrine of presumption of constitutionality means, generally it talks about, for example, Article 13. If anything comes to a Supreme Court, High Court for a judicial review, for example, a law passed by central government, state government is challenged under judicial review, then what will Supreme Court assume? Supreme Court will assume that that law is constitutionally valid. Now it is upon the petitioner to prove that it is unconstitutional. So basically the assumption is that law is constitutionally valid. So these are few doctrines. Okay. So I think these were the few things that you should know regarding the current affair topics. So that's all for the most probable question series, prediction series for 2024 prelims from Polity. So I hope you have gained something from this lecture series, and hope you will study well and prepare for your prelims now that the prelims has been postponed to 16th June. Okay, so best of luck and thank you.